Hi, welcome back. I'm Claire Cousins and it's good to see you and I hope you're all well. In this video, I'm going to be sharing with you how I would do a little mini landscape to go into one of my little booklets. I used to do lots of larger landscapes, but now I choose to go a bit smaller, quicker, and you can do them in a short amount of time. And they're more enjoyable. I feel they're more enjoyable for me now because I can just have a little rummage in my jars. So what I tend to do, let me just show you, I tend to keep these jars, just old sweet jars, and they're all full of my scraps. That's my blue one and this is my green one, and I'm going to be selecting some fabrics out of there and show you how I build up my little miniature landscapes for free motion embroidery and for hand stitching. You don't have to free motion embroider if you're not confident, but I'm going to show you how I do it. So come and join me at my desk. Right, the first thing I do is I get myself a nice little basket, and I tend to pull out, because the jar is so full of bits and bobs, I tend to pull out some fabrics until I see something I like the look of or want to use. And then, oh, I might actually stop. So there's actually something there I could use for the sky, possibly. Yeah, I think I might use that for the sky. I might lay some, just discovered some net and some organzas. So I might put some organzas in the sky as well. So I found what I'd like to use for the sky. So I'm going to pull those little bits to one side and put the bits that I don't want back in my box. And I do the same with the green, pull out the little textures, the bits and bobs I like. I thought I would share with you my selection of green fabrics. I've got quite a mix in here, so you can see I've got some Indian cottons, and then I've also got some Thai silks. And if you mix up, there's some hand-dyed batik, some upholstery material there, and if you mix up your textures, you can get some really interesting effects. I've got some sort of like a worsted suit material. I've also got what's quite nice is some bits of muslin that's not been particularly well dyed, it's quite pale, so I could re-dye that. Hessian's always a nice thing to have, some more muslin. Oh, that's a better colour, muslin, butter muslin. There's also bits of silk. So when I keep my little scrap bits, I do tend to keep them all mixed up. There's some bits of organza with some stitching on from a previous project. Nice little bit of texture there, again from a previous project. And I could, any of these bits and bobs I could incorporate. Organzas are lovely to layer up to get some depth. I can get some bits of felt. This is a beautiful hand-dyed felt. I can't remember if that was from 21st Century or whether that was from, could have been from Sandra, who knows. I've also got some, what else have I got in here, bits of, again, sort of more like a, I don't really know what you'd call that really, apart from sort of like almost like a crepe de chine. Some saris. I've also got little bits of lace in here from an old skirt, believe it or not. It's always good to recycle. So one of my daughter's old skirts when she was a little girl. Some silk velvet that I'd hand dyed. So all these little bits and bobs can make for a beautiful landscape. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pop these into this basket so I can just rummage as and when I feel I need it. Sometimes I don't like to be restricted. That's some hand-painted Tyvek. Now those of you who have never used it, it's a product that's used in the construction industry, and it's also used in museums to protect some items when they're on the move. And you can paint it and then you can heat it and it will form quite a crunchy texture. But believe it or not, you can sew into it, especially into these areas of like a French knot. It's a really interesting effect. Oh, some more upholstery fabric with some interesting textures. So I'm going to crack on now and show you how I start laying out my ideas on my piece of fabric. Right, okay, this is the little book, little concertina book I was thinking of creating. I've already stained it different shades of green in readiness for it. It's just regular heavyweight cardboard. I've cut a piece of cheap felt to fit it. I wanted a top and a bottom slightly showing there, so that's what's going on there. So that's my piece of base fabric. I've then already selected a bit of the blue for my sky. Now I've cut it on a diagonal because I always think that looks more interesting to start off with an unusual cutting. This piece of fabric was actually the mop-up from the dyeing, the block printing I did quite early on in the series. It was the mop-up of the paint palettes. So as I say, fabric's never wasted. Always mop up any paint that's left over. Now I've selected some different shades of and different textures of green. I've got some mostly, these will have gone for mostly sort of quite thin cottons because it's quite small. If it's too bulky, it doesn't look quite right. So I've got a little selection there of my lovely fabrics. I like to start off with a darkish in the background. Now people say to me, oh, do you use a picture? Well, actually no, I don't use a picture. It's in my head. You can obviously use a picture for reference. I have found that when I've done that, I get quite frustrated, and the reason being is, like, you know, it takes a little while to get it as you really want it to be. So I tend to do, I'm a bit sort of inspired by Bob Ross in so much as he just seems to put things where he fancies putting stuff. So I've just put a mountain in there. I think what I might do is have a bit of an overlapping something going on there, so I'm just going to cut that and see how it looks. You can see I'm just playing with it. It might be that it's perhaps got another hill coming in from this side. Put some more of this darker one just to frame it. I'm just at the moment cutting random triangles and then placing them where I think I'd like them. I think I did like that first time. There you go. Got a collection of, I might bring that slightly more. Now I've got a collection of distant hills. It might be that it's lock inspired and I might have a bit of water in the front there, but I do need a bit of a foreshore. If I'm going to go for that type of thing, I need a foreshore. I don't know whether that's too jadey. It might be too jadey. The foreshore I might have to create with stitch. Having said that, it's quite a nice bit of brown just there, so I might use that as my foreshore. I'm just going to rip that because if by ripping it you get quite a nice texture going on. As you can see, that bit of my mountain needs to come off, so I'm going to cut that away. I don't really want that in the way there. It might be that actually this mountain is slightly forward of that mountain and the lake disappears into the back. Hang on, might need to cut this one a bit bigger. As I say, they're just scraps, so it doesn't matter. That needs to come there. I've got one foreshore, then I've got to do a little bit of a foreshore going on there. Now, I should really have popped some blue in there. What I might do is raise my mountains a little bit taller so I can get more of that lock in. Whoops. Like that. hiding this here and then bringing I'm going to put some of this sparkle into this and a couple of strips of this. I'm going to cover that with a little bit of organza to hold that in place, and again to add the shimmer. So I'm popping that over the top. And as I say, this is something I'm just building up and playing as I'm going. It's not planned at all. So I'm just what you're seeing me creating is how did I have that? Wasn't it? It's that way. That's why I'm struggling. Right, there we go. That's better. For sure, is it? Dips into the lock, and then we want something just here at the front, so this is where we're going to go for this. I don't know if that's too pale or whether we need to go for this one. We might go for that one, just a little strip of that. Already, hopefully you can see the textures building up. Might use some of this scrunched up in places. So I've cut a few pieces, fray it out a little bit to get the textures, pop it on. Right, out a little bit. You can see me stretching and pulling it, and that will give me the textures that I want in the foreground. This looks a little bit solid. What I might do is put some rips into there so it doesn't look quite so solid. Or it might be that actually I put it underneath the organza. No, not sure. I think what I might do is actually give that a bit of a shaping. It was ripped to try and get some texture, but now I'm not so sure. I think I want it a bit more scraggy, so I'm just going to really rough it up a bit and make it look more organically natural, because at the moment it was looking too neat. No, I quite like neat landscapes. Natural landscapes aren't particularly neat, and that actually that's better just by roughing it up. That's helped. So already you can see how that's building up. Now what I would do is I would pin it, and I might even tack it to hold it in place. Then once I've done that, I'll go to the machine. Few pins in, just to show you what I mean. I would just pin, not everywhere, just the odd place, so it didn't move too much. Now the only thing with doing this on a mat is that invariably I will have pinned it to the mat. Oh, it's not too bad, just that one. And hopefully you can see where I'm getting to. Okay, so I've got all my pieces pinned into place, and I'm just going to tack them down with some tacking thread. Tacking thread is usually one that's so loosely spun that when you pull it, it breaks easily. It shouldn't actually hurt your fingers when you tear it. And that's tacking thread. And then what I'm going to do, where these pins are, I'm just going to put just a couple of large stitches. Hold the key pieces down. Smaller pieces are lifting off at the moment, but that doesn't matter for now. I might just take them off while I do this. So just loosely hand stitching across to hold the key components. Anything that's fallen off, like these little bits here, I might have to put in place as I'm sewing. As you can hear, that is my cat meowing in the background. So I'm just going to go and let her out. Right, and carry on. So I'm just going to stitch a couple more bits down. Holding the organza down on that edge there. Might run my way down here because this lock seems to want to keep moving. Bits. That is probably enough to get me going. I think I might leave this piece off because I can sew underneath it and then stitch that on the top later. So I might actually not tack that down. I'll take that out for now. I can sew those bits on separately. Right, okie dokie. So I've got the main bits tacked. Can I go to my machine? Okay, what I've got here is I've had a look through my threads, and this is a Gutermann variegated. So cotton 30. They're okay, not too bad. I've got myself a metallic that I like. I used to sell this particular brand. This one, I think, I'm not entirely sure, but I think I picked that up at one of the traders. Beautiful variegated thread. And then this one is a Wonderfill Mirage. And again, I don't always remember where I pick my threads up, but that's quite a nice sort of rayon. It's got a nice shimmer to it. All of these threads, I'd recommend you change your needle in your machine to an embroidery needle or a metallic needle. The eyes are much bigger, so that is one thing I will tell you. And I will also recommend that you actually use a feed from the back, so I'll explain that now. So let me just, right, when I'm using these threads, I tend to use one of these. It's got a cast iron base with a spool holder. You pop it in and then you feed it up to the top, and then you feed that at the back of your machine. Let me show you the back of my machine. There, can you see I'm feeding it from the back of the machine, and I'm feeding it in as if it's round my spool as normal. And that just allows a smoother flow. Make sure it stays hooked on, that's the one thing I will warn you. So it just hooks on there and just pulls better through your machine. So that's a tip I will give you. Okay, so I've threaded the machine. I've put a very neutral bobbin underneath, so I don't have to keep changing the bobbin, so it's just a grey. I've lifted part of my mounting up out of the way, which is why it's important that you don't stitch it fully down. I've lowered mid presser foot. The machine's already been preset for free motion embroidery, so the dog teeth are down. I've got my embroidery foot on. I'm going to gently lower my needle into the machine and pick up my thread. I did mention in, did I mention the last video? I can't remember if I did like mention it, but people have asked me, what sort of threads do you use? Do you know what? It doesn't matter what brand it is. It's, if it's for artwork, it's whatever you feel looks nice, and if it feels, if it looks good. I like to use variegated because it doesn't look so harsh. Right, I'm just restarting because it didn't bring the bobbin up last time. Okie dokie. There we go. I like to make sure the bobbin is up because then it doesn't bird nest underneath. Lower my needle foot and then I can start sewing. Now with free motion embroidery, you can go in any direction. At the moment I'm just going like I would normally sew, but this is where now it doesn't matter. I can go back and I can put a little bit of a wiggle in. I can come forward again, put some texture in my lock here. You might not want to stitch everywhere. You might want to give it some ripples. Now I'm starting on the lock purely because grass and foliage grows over the top of it. So you want to get the one item that you know is definitely going to be underneath something else. So in this case, it's the lock. And then everything else can go over the top of it. So I've secured that. I can cut it off and I can change my thread. I've changed to the green thread now, which is a rayon, and I'm going to try and get a little bit of texture in this mountain. So I'm going to go around the edge. This is almost like a raw edge appliqué technique. Now you'll notice that the thread is coming with me, so ideally I do need to cut those threads. I've just stopped to cut those threads. Now I can carry on. And initially I'm just going to go around just to hold it in place. And then what I can do is start to put some textures in. I can go one way, I can go another way, I can just meander. I'm going to sew this one down because I can see this chap's going to move. I'm going to go around that one. And I really do feel there's no right and wrong way to this. It's about playing and creating. You follow the artistic rules on proportion and perspective. But at the end of the day, it's about having fun. I'm going to go around in little circles on this little bit here to suggest that perhaps it's a bit of scrubland, a bit of pebbles. That's the shoreline on the far side. I'm going to put some little dips and textures into this mountain a bit across the top a bit more. I've just stopped to add these little tiny bits because these came off during tacking, so I'm just placing them where I want them to be. I think I want them too thick. I might put those ones there. Thicker ones here, perhaps. Okay, so I'm going to come back down and secure them in place. And again, I'm just going to do like a stippling stitch. I'm going round and round in circles, They're just squiggling around just to secure them where I want them. And if it's not quite where I want them, you can just lift up your foot, get a little pin, position them where you do want them, lower your foot back down, and then just carry on. I'm going to get this one into place. Position that in place, I want it. Oops! Now that clanking noise tells me that I've forgotten to lower my foot. So it might not carry on because it's bird nested underneath. So I'm going to pull it out. And I'm going to try again. Bring my needle up and my thread up. From underneath, will it come up? There it is. Keep checking now. Put that bit of shawl in there. And then carry on. So if you do jam it, you'll hear the sound. And you can just stop, it's not a problem. I do it, so it's let's find out what's wrong. Didn't like that bit of fabric, I think it was. Let's have a look, see. Okay. Now, this is what I mean by birds nesting. It's happened twice, and I think this last time it happened, I think my rayon has actually jumped out of my tension discs. That was the one I did when I forgot to lower the foot, which is probably where the fault started to begin with. So I can cut them all off. If it affects the front, it affects the front. So let's have a look, see. Affect the front. Well, it hasn't affected the front too much, so that's good. So we can leave them in as it is. It's not going to fall apart. It's a picture at the end of the day. It's not going to be washed. Got some threads that I'll pull out. So already you can see how the landscape is developing. I'm going to add a bit of green now to my foreground. And then I think it's ready to have the tacking out and do a little bit of finishing off with some hand stitching. So, I'm going to pin that. What I could do is I could use a thicker thread on the bobbin. Quite tempted to do that actually. A thicker thread on the bobbin, and I could show you a really interesting technique. I'm going to pause it there because my cat is meowing at me again. And I'm going to go and find some thicker thread. Okay, the technique I'm about to show you, you can just about make it out on here. It's where a thicker thread was machine embroidered into it. So it's been done on there. And I've got another example here. I don't know if you can see the textures just in there. And the way that is done is you get yourself your bobbin and you get yourself a thicker thread. Now this is looks like a sort of a type of perlay with a bit of a metallic feeding through it. And again, I've picked it up from one of the traders at the fair. And I'm just going to wind that. You have to, unfortunately, you do have to wind it by hand. And you wind on as much as you feel you need. It's only a small piece, so I probably could stop there. Now, in the previous video, I said I'd had a different bobbin unit inside that I've slackened off. So this is the one I've took out. And you could either try on your machine not to put it through the feed or just have a looser feed. In this case, I'm going to show you if you don't put it in your feed. So I'm actually not going to follow the threading up system. I'm going to do it so it's actually loose. And fingers crossed, it will work. It doesn't always work first time. So please don't get frustrated. The best thing to do is to keep experimenting. Now, instead of sewing from this way up, you're going to turn it over. What I've done is I've positioned my pins here to help me so I know roughly where I'm going. It could be that you have a row of tacking instead. And then I'm going to start off where I want it to start. And I can't pull the bobbin right through, but I can bring it to the surface of the machine. So I do want to see it. Let me just lift that foot a bit higher. Can you see I've just pulled it up? There it is. And then make sure your foot's lowered again. Hold both ends. And as before, you sew. And because it's, I want it to look like plants, shrubbery growing, I'm just going in all sorts of directions, nowhere in particular, some up and down, some side to side, some in circles, trying to keep it as random as possible. Avoiding the pins at all times. And if the first time you go across isn't enough, go across again. So I'm going to stop there. I'm going to have a quick look, see. Oh, and you can see, let me just zoom in. Hopefully you can see the beautiful textures. I might actually have a look because that might be, oh, that is enough. I'm happy with that. If you can see those lovely textures. Right, that's more than enough. So I'm going to take that out. Put my other bobbin back in. Yes, I know it's a metal one. Fortunately, it's just handy. And then this time I'm just going to add some more texture with regular embroidery. Okay, I've moved the sewing machine out of the way now, and hopefully you can see, oh, hang on, what I've produced. I'm going to take my tacking out. And because I've used tacking thread, it should just break and make it easier to come out. There we go. Now, I could choose to leave the edges organic. I think I might trim it up. Now, I could trim it up, let's have a look-see, with just my pinking shears. Let's see how that looks. It's quite nice. Yeah, I think I'll do that. Or I can get my rotary cutter out. If you don't feel confident with it being straight. I'll find my card. I might add some beads to it, I might give it a bit of a press. And once it's on the card, I think that would look quite pretty. I think definitely beads and some French knots will finish that off. What I'll do, I'll stitch those on and then I'll show you it a close-up shot of it at the end. Thank you for joining me. I hope that's been informative. As I say, it's just build it how you want to build it. It's your fantasy land. Nobody can tell you if it's right and wrong. Just enjoy. Thank you very much for joining me today. Bye bye. I thought I'd add a bit more to this. I was looking at it and I thought, well, actually, it lacks a tree, lacks a focal point. So I've actually cut some lengths of different browns and different greys of hand embroidery thread, you know, six stranded thread, and I'm going to place these down in such a way to produce a trunk. I've got some roots, and these ones, when I position them as I'm working, will form the branches. So I've got that there. I'm just going to set up my machine, because believe it or not, you can free motion this too. So we're going to give that a go. I've laid those six stranded embroidery threads that I cut earlier onto the piece where I want it. I've threaded up my machine. I've gone for black. I probably would have preferred perhaps a darker brown, but I've gone for black because I think it might make a better contrast anyway. And then I'm actually going to set my sewing machine to a very fine zigzag. So let me just set that. Let me just check it. I'm going to hand check it before I do anything more. And it's so fine, it's not hardly being moved. That's better. And I'm going to just couch these down. So I'm just going to stop for a minute because I've got a thread I want to trim off. There we go. And already you can see that tree is couched down. I'm now going to also try and couch these roots. So I'm positioning them where I want them to go. And then I'm just, and you can trail off your zigzag will look thinner if you go from side to side. So if you go from side to side, it'll just hold them down. If you go forward, it's like a regular zigzag. I'm going to do a bit of a hollow in here as if the rabbits have made a burrow. I'm just making sure there's a bit of stitching there. Couching these threads this way. Now this is where I need to decide when my branches are going. So I might start off with four to create a bigger branch, and then I might split it off again later. So I've got quite a big branch. I'm going to stop. I'm going to split them off a bit more. I think I might follow this one up here and off. Follow this one up this way. Go back to these two up here. Come up. I might stop there so I can position those where I want them. And then carry on. And to be honest with you, if you've got random stitches, it's just twigs growing off the branch. So I might go off somewhere. Ooh, it's a random twig there. You'll notice I do stop and reconsider where I'm going. Just going to go that. Might split this one again. What have we got? Might have some twigs coming off it. Now it is odd stitching with a zigzag mode on, but it does make it look more tree-like. Let's have a look at my tree. Just trim that there. Trim that there. Trim off the edges. I might decide that the contrast doesn't really show too well, and I can come in with a paler stitch to bring out some of the colour. Hopefully that's given you some ideas. Thanks for joining me, and see you again soon. Bye bye. In the last video I was using the sewing machine and I thought I'd finished. I decided that the tree, you couldn't really see it, so I've gone over it with a bit more colour, and then I'm actually now adding some leaves, and I've decided to go for a lazy daisy. So you come up, you go in, you come up around and go back down again. And if I cluster them, it can look like a little cluster of leaves on a branch. And if you vary your colour green, as you can see, I started off with a much limier green. I've now changed to a lighter colour. It gives it another dimension, and especially if you intermingle the colours a bit as well. So I'm going to carry on doing that on my tree to bring that out. I'm going to also put some grass down here and some beads. So I'll come back in a bit.